good seed flowing from this here buck. Look at them teeth, huh? I'll start them out at 200. 150? Come on now, I gotta make a living here, gents. 100? 75? Sold! Get out of here. Put a yoke on here. Bring her up here. Now, consider this comely wench. Not a day over 18. All right, I'll start her off at 175. I got 175. Do I hear two? Now we're talking. Do I got 225?
Master, that wench's dad sure make a good wedding gift for Miss Catherine.
225.
She keeps saying she's been asking.
Do I hear 250?
She looks right young, if you ask me.
Come on now.
You're right, sir. She young.
250. Come on.
But with the right teacher.
Give me 250.
Wench like that.
250.
Could be working a long time.
There it is. 275.
Master, it sure will be a shame to watch her go to waste for such a low price.
275.
What the hell would you know about what's a little and what's a lot, huh?
275 for me?
I don't know what's gotten into you lately, but whatever it is, you better quit.
Seeing what I'm seeing, you take this one home, you know, clean her up. Won't be long before you find yourself happier than a dog with three balls. Smile, bitch. That's 250 going once. 250 going twice.
275.
We got 275. 275 going once. 275 going twice. Sold to that fine gentleman in the back.
New York, New York. It is arguably still the preeminent global financial center. As far as money and media go, it's the city that's the world headquarters for both. And so perhaps the title Center of the World is fitting. But here's an unpleasant reality less talked about. While New York, both the city and the state, were centers of the abolitionist struggle to finally end slavery, it was actually enslaved Africans that built the infrastructure of the colonial city. And it was that way from the 1600s to 1827, when slavery was legally abolished in New York City. We rarely think of New York as a slave-holding city, but it had more slaves than any other city except Charleston, South Carolina. It's inconvenient, uncomfortable, and for some, shameful. Perhaps that's why many shy away from talking about it. But not Alan Singer, who's lived in New York all his life. Dr. Singer is a professor of secondary education at Hofstra University and a former New York City High School social studies teacher. He's the author of New York and Slavery, Time to Teach the Truth. I met with Dr. Singer in Lower Manhattan. He agreed to take us to some of the most important sites related to slavery here. The African Burial Cemetery was used between the late 1600s and 1796. And originally contained between 10 and 20,000 burials. Despite the harsh treatment that these African people experienced in colonial America, the 427 bodies that eventually were recovered were actually buried with great care and love. They were wrapped in linen shrouds and placed in coffins that sometimes contained beads or other treasured objects.
And what happens is, the burial ground is listed on old New York City maps, but in the 1790s, as the city grew, the burial ground itself was just paved over. And then in the 1990s, the federal government decided to build this new office building here. And when they excavated this site for the foundation, they found hundreds and maybe thousands of bodies that had been buried prior to 1790. And all of a sudden, there was a tremendous investigation because what they discovered from the maps, this is the African burial ground. What happens is as New York City grew, people are familiar that Wall Street had a wall. But Wall Street wall was in 1664 when it was a Dutch city, New Amsterdam. When at the time of the American Revolution, it's a British city, and the wall is actually on Chambers Street, just on the other side of this building. Africans, even though they were Christian, were considered to be heathen, and they were not allowed to be buried on the church grounds within the city limits. So they are buried outside the wall. in this area just outside New York City. Now, part of the reason that this area was used, it's also very swampy. Just below, we'll see, is what an area they called the Collect, and behind that is an area called Five Points. It's very swampy areas. As a result, they were not prime for people to live. This was used as the African burial ground. The whole area was just paved over. It was lost to history. It was erased from the past and was only found when they started digging the foundation for this office building.
The African American community demanded answers after the cemetery was rediscovered in the 1900s.
What eventually happens is forensic scientists and anthropologists, archaeologists from Howard University investigate, they establish who these people were, they study the bones, they recognize the hardness of their life, and then the people, about 500 people who are dug up, are then reinterred in a ceremony in these mounds. So these mounds contain about the remains of 500 people who originally were buried out through that whole area.
Singer says that at the time of the American Revolution, around the 1780s, the population of New York was about 10,000. 15% of that population were enslaved Africans.
In the United States, people usually think that slavery is an institution of the South. But slavery is actually a national institution. Now, in a place like New York, we're not looking at plantations. And we're not looking at primarily agricultural work. We're looking at people building the infrastructure of the city. We're looking at people clearing forests. We're looking at people building roads, building fortifications, dredging harbors. And the people who did this work were enslaved Africans.
As we walked across the city to Foley Square, Alan tells me about how it was here that enslaved Africans, free blacks and white supporters accused of plotting the 1741 slave conspiracy were executed. White New Yorkers, afraid of a slave revolt, responded to rumors and unexplained fires with the arrest of 146 enslaved Africans, the execution of 35 blacks and 4 whites, and the transport to other colonies of 70 enslaved people. Historians continue to doubt whether a slave conspiracy ever existed.
1741, it's a bitter cold winter. It is so cold that the Hudson River freezes. What happens is, we're talking about a ruined town. People are just burning whatever they can to keep warm, and there are fires that break out. In April, the white population of the city suspects that the black population, the enslaved population, is planning a rebellion. And then all of a sudden, 1741, over 150 enslaved Africans are arrested and accused of plotting this rebellion. What's interesting is the whites did not believe that the Africans could plan it, so they actually arrest a white tavern owner and accuse him of planning the uprising. So they're put on trial. And what happens at the trial is the Africans are basically given a deal. If you confess, we will send you to Barbados to live out the rest of your life on the sugar plantations. But if you don't confess, we're going to burn you alive at the stake. Some people confess. The 4 whites are hung. What happens is that the 2 of the Africans who accused of being the ringleaders, they refuse to confess. And they drag them here to burn them alive. And they threaten to burn their families alive. And the 2 men ultimately, they say, okay, we'll confess. And there's a mob of whites here, and they scream and they want them executed, and these men are burned alive.
Here?
Right here at Foley Square. The thing is, with flesh burning on open flames, the stink would permeate the entire city of New York. Now, one of the things is, there's actually a woodcut drawing of the scene. It shows families coming to watch the scene, very reminiscent of some of the scenes from the French Revolution of the guillotine. There's a commentator from New England who looks at the trial transcript and said, this is like the Salem witch trials. This is an hysterical population, fearful because of fire. All of a sudden attacks a helpless group of people, enslaved Africans, executes 35 enslaved Africans, and the 4 whites they believe are the ringleaders. Happens right here in the city of New York.
Navigating our way through the busy streets of downtown, we arrive at New York's famous City Hall. Although slavery ends in New York State legally in 1827, city merchants and bankers continued to be tied to slave trade and slave-produced commodities. For example, William Havemeyer, mayor of New York City, launched his political career from the family's sugar refining business. The sugar was produced in the South and Cuba by enslaved African labor.
Havemeyer owns a sugar company, which offices are just across the East River in Brooklyn. At the time, it's known as Havemeyer Sugar. Now it's known as Domino Sugar. Domino Sugar, owned by the mayor of the city of New York, is producing sugar in the Caribbean, and it's being processed in Brooklyn and distributed around the world.
Another New York mayor, Fernando Wood, who later becomes a congressman, opposed and campaigned heavily against the 13th Amendment to the United States Constitution, which abolished slavery.
In 1861, as the nation is moving to civil war, the South is starting to secede, the mayor of the city of New York actually gives a speech to the New York City Council, and he proposes that New York City secede along with the South. And he makes this proposal because he says they owe us so much money and we are so commercially tied together. If they leave and we stay, how will they ever pay us back?
But it wasn't just the sugar trade, it was also cotton. Singer writes in his book, the founders of Brown Brothers Harriman built their bank by lending millions of dollars to Southern planters and arranging for the shipment and sale of slave-grown cotton. When the bank took control of three Louisiana plantations at one point, it also got 346 enslaved Africans. John Jacob Astor, America's first multimillionaire, made his fortune in part through cotton transportation. He was also part of the slave trade. The Waldorf Astoria Hotel and neighborhoods in New York City are named after him. Lehman Brothers, a merchandising business that quickly evolved into a cotton brokerage firm, is another example. And finally, Charles L. Tiffany, who got the financing to open a fancy goods store from his father, who operated a cotton mill in Connecticut using cotton picked by Southern slave labor. Tiffany & Co., the internationally renowned jeweler, was born. The list goes on. Today, the South Street Seaport is one of New York's many waterfront tourist attractions, with restaurants and gift shops. Singer explains that although in 1807 it was illegal to bring slave Africans into the United States, a restaurant named Sweets continued to be the meeting place of the global slave trade in secret, and just up the street was the bank that financed the slave trade, Citibank.
The complex here dates from 1810. It's one of the oldest building complexes in the city of New York. But what happens, and then the waterfront is right here. What happens in the 1850s, there's a restaurant in this building right in front of us called Sweets. And Sweets is the meeting place of the global slave trade. Boats are outfitted in the harbor of New York, and what happens is it's illegal to bring enslaved Africans into the United States after 1807. In fact, the slave trade itself has been declared illegal by Great Britain and the United States. It's a capital offense after 1820 for an American to be involved in the slave trade. But we have documentation of what's happening because in 1854, one of the slave traders is arrested. He's turned in by his crew. He cheats them on pay. He's furious that he's being put on trial for slave trading. So he testifies, and his testimony is on the front page of the New York Times. And then later, he writes it up into a book. And what he says is that at Sweets, at South Street Seaport, at this restaurant, the slave traders meet to plan their voyages. And a couple blocks up this way, south of us on South Street, is the bank that finances the slave trade. And what they're doing is they call the Africans black ivory, and what they do is they outfit the boats here, they then sail to Africa. In Africa, they load enslaved Africans and they bring them back to Cuba. Amistad is not an isolated case, but Amistad is part of this transatlantic shipment of human beings.
Dr. Singer was the director of the New York and Slavery Complicity and Resistance Curriculum. April Francis, Allen's former student at Hofstra University, joined us later on the tour, along with her son Jalen, a senior in high school. April was a history major and is a graduate of the Teacher Certification Program. She also holds a master's degree and certificate of advanced study. April helped edit and field test the New York and Slavery Complicity and Resistance curriculum. She teaches social studies at Lawrence Road Middle School in Uniondale, New York, where she is a cooperating teacher for students in the Hofstra Teacher Education Program. In 2005, the New York and Slavery Complicity and Resistance curriculum was awarded a National Council for the Social Studies Program of Excellence Award.
It was actually very shocking, you know, teaching history. Normally we talk about the North and South being predominantly the area that slavery was the institution there. I knew New York once had slaves, but I didn't know New York was one of the last northern states to end slavery. So when I found out all this history, not just about, you know, I'm thinking more rural area of New York, but right here in New York City, the amount of history and information that was sitting right here that no one really knew about, it was very interesting, and I really wanted to participate in the project with him and help get that history out to our students and just to the general public.
Alan, April, and other team members have presented the New York and Slavery curriculum at local, state, and national social studies conferences so teachers can have a blueprint on presenting their students with the opportunity to learn about slavery in New York and better understand race relations in general. Teachers can voluntarily choose to put the subject on their curriculum, but are not required. I ask April why she thinks that is.
I think it's not that they want to hide, but it's a painful history. So how do you teach something without evoking emotion? And then when that emotion, you know, comes out, how do you help students deal with it? So a lot of teachers are apprehensive because they don't know how to deal with the portion of the why question, or how to deal with not feeling connected to that history. So, you know, non-African American teachers sometimes don't feel comfortable speaking about it because of the pain behind it. So I wouldn't say that they're trying to hide it. It's just hard to discuss. But I think utilizing the curriculum, it allows people to take a step back and just use the material and say, this is the information, this is the primary source documents, and have that discussion and say, where are we at today and how can we move forward from this history?
April says, as uncomfortable as it may be, it's important to know this part of New York's history.
The topic of slavery is painful, but I believe that remembering, it's important to remember that history and not wipe it as a clean slate to act like it never existed, because then you're saying all those people sacrificed their lives and did the hard work of building up this area didn't exist. So it's important to say that we need to remember it, and it is painful to teach, but some of history isn't always that great, but it allows us to know where we don't want to be anymore. And for teachers that have maybe a little bit apprehensive in teaching it, just letting them know that we have to give all sides of the story and allow the students to then determine or make their own judgments on that. So we as educators are there to give them the resources and allow them to help them to learn how to critically think. Then we have to give them that information. So all information is needed, no matter how painful we may feel it is in teaching it.
America's dark past, kind of, because, you know, not every country, but just that was just our country's fault, you know, the racism and the slavery. It was just, but it was a time in the past, and it still carries on now. Like, you see that with all the things happening now. And some people try to sweep it on the rug and don't teach it, like I said, in my school, but it's something that we should know, we should learn about.
1711, there's a brisk business in slaves, both in purchase and rental of slave labor. What happens is the boats come right up to the Wall Street grain market. And in 1711, the town council, called the Common Council, decides that to coordinate the sale and rental of enslaved Africans, and really to make sure that they keep track and to prevent rebellion, All sale and rental of slave Africans will take place at the Wall Street slave market right over here. And again, it was documented in the minutes of the town council. And in this curriculum that we developed, we include it. But there was never a marker here.
Back in June, New York Mayor Bill de Blasio dedicated this plaque steps away from what was once the Wall Street slave market. The plaque honors those who passed through the slave market, located near Pearl and Water Streets. During a memorial, the mayor said it was true to three centuries ago, even though it was never acknowledged. It was true then, it is true today. It will be true tomorrow.
It's been 3 years since the financial crisis crippled the American economy. And much to the consternation of the general public and the demonstrators on Wall Street, there's not been a single prosecution of a high-ranking Wall Street executive or major financial firm, even though fraud and financial misrepresentations played a significant role in the meltdown.
So what we're looking at here is an old picture or painting of the tip of Manhattan circa 1651. Back then it was known as New Amsterdam. Now the triangular slave trade made a major stop in New York before it went to the Caribbean islands. And the slave ships was owned by a company called the Dutch West India Company. You had the Dutch West India Company. You also had the Dutch East India Company. The Dutch West India Company came to New York and traded slaves for molasses and for rum, and also straight up sold them at the slave auctions. Now, it was an estimated amount of 40,000 ships that came through the triangular trade for more than 400 years, with an average of 80 persons per day. And the profits they used to make off the slaves are ridiculous. For example, around 1675, when selling slaves was at its peak, a slave could be bought in West Africa for $355 and sold in New York for $3,793. Now, as you can see on this map, which this map is called the Castello Plan, if you want to look it up, you can see the slave ships coming in and docking on the Lower East Side of Manhattan. That's the East River there on the bottom portion of the map. And all along the coast there of Manhattan are piers where they would unload the cargo, which included slaves and other material. And then they would move the slaves on to go be sold. Here's another version of the same map. This map has street names. And as you can see, a lot of these street names you'll recognize, like Wall Street, Broadway, we have Bowling Green, we have Pearl Street down here. And if you're from New York or you recognize the Manhattan area, you'll notice there's a lot of street names that are not present here, or even some street names that you don't recognize. This is because since those times, Esau has dumped a lot of landfills on the coast of the tip of Manhattan to build more businesses, and there's a lot of streets that are there now that did not previously exist. Like, for example, Water Street and Front Street. Now, I'm going to blow this up because I want to bring attention to Wall Street. Now, most people, when they think of Wall Street, they're thinking of the whole financial district as Wall Street, which is incorrect. Wall Street is actually named after a wall that was built by Israelite slaves. And by the way, all the names here in Lower Manhattan are all Dutch names. These are the English versions of the names. For instance, Wall Street is actually Wallstraat, Waalstraat, if I'm spelling it correctly. These are just the English versions. And Wall Street, as you can see, surrounding Wall Street, going outlining some of the coast over here on the west side, is an actual wall, and it was built by the slaves for the Edomites to protect them from the English Edomites, because these were the Dutch, and also to protect their investments from Gadites raiding them, and also to prevent slaves from escaping. Now, if you notice, there's a lot of buildings here, a lot of houses. If you look here, where I'm highlighting, there's a lot of houses here. There's a lot of trees and farmland. This was all built by slaves, Israelite slaves. All of this entire thing here. So here we have a more updated 3D map of the Lower Manhattan. And if we look here, we can see this is the East River, and this is where the ships came in, the slave ships, to dock. And as you can see here, there's actually some ships that are docked right over here. But over here is where Wall Street is, and there's also a pier here. Now, remember, in the times we're talking about, the water was pushed up a lot more than this. So let's go down into Wall Street. And if I turn around, you can see here's the river where the ships used to float down. And they used to dock the slaves right off the coast here. And if you notice, there's no wall here like there used to be. They took everything out that would remind them of the wickedness that they've done, and to basically to hide what they've done. And that's why you don't hear about this on in schools. You don't hear anything about the slave activity that went on in New York. Now, if we go up Wall Street some more, we're going to go up to Wall and Water Street, which should be right here. Now, this corner here of Water and Wall Street, in 1711, the first New York slave auction was built here. Now, a lot of the pictures of the slave auctions that we use on the camp signs and that you brothers use for your signs, a lot of them came from the slave market or the auction that used to happen right here on Water and Wall Street in New York. So what happened is the slaves would come in and they would bring them up Wall Street, and they would bring them to this market here. And here they would be traded, they would be bought, they would be sold. And also this acted as a workforce. So if you needed, if a cracker needed a slave to work on whatever, they would come here, and this was like a labor-ready type of thing for them. Now, right across from the slave market right here, this is 82 Wall Street. 82 Wall Street, back in those times, used to be a coffee shop. It was called the Tontine Coffee Shop. And what happened is the slave owners, the slave buyers, the traders, when they left the slave auctions, and even when the ships docked on Wall Street by the river, they would come here. They would count their inventory, they would make trades, they would make business deals with different slaves. And back then, slaves were stock, because, you know, we know what money is. Money is gold, silver, land, and livestock. Well, back then, and even today, slaves were considered as livestock. So those were riches, and that was stock. So right here at the Tontine Coffee Shop is where they used to do their trading and their stock investments. And this eventually became what is known today as the largest stock exchange in the world, which is the New York Stock Exchange.